Welcome back to a series of lectures on igneous and metamorphic petrology. So in this lecture, we would like to discuss about the Bowens reaction principle.
This is the third lecture of igneous petrology.
So in this lecture, we would like to discuss about the Bowens reaction principle. Last class, what we have seen, what is igneous rocks, how igneous rocks are formed, and what is the major classification of igneous rocks, and how the igneous rocks are classified based on magmatic composition, magma characteristics. And N.L. Bowen, who he is the scientist, of course, this there is a very small introduction is given in the introductory part of remote sensing, sorry, igneous petrology. N.L. Bowen, he is a famous petrologist born in 1887 in Canada. So Norman Levy Bowen, so he is the first scientist who has brought how different minerals are formed or crystallized under varying pressure and conditions. He is a very famous petrologist who has studied a continuous series of magma, how magma at a different pressure and temperature slowly it gets crystallized in a continuous process, in a discontinuous process. So it's very, very, very important for an igneous petrologist to understand his results on understanding how different rocks are formed or crystallized under various temperature and pressure conditions. And we know that igneous rocks are the product, end product of crystallization of magma. And it is normally noticed on the surface or near the surface or below the surface. And this all class, igneous rocks are classified based on four characteristics, four basic types of magma. It is classified by a famous geologist, N.L. Bowen. He has classified this four magma based on the chemistry of the magmatic characteristics. That is the beauty of it. And we will see the four major classification of magma: felsic magma, intermediate magma, mafic magma, and ultramafic magma. So this classification is mainly based on the percentage of silica content in the magma. Felsic magma is one which has got high quantities of sodium, aluminium, potassium, and silicate. And here, the percentage of silica is more than 65% in felsic magma. The product of the silica high component is the end product of, we will get granite from this type of magma, dacite from this type of magma, rhyolite, and granodiorite. So these are all the end product, normal, commonly found end product from felsic magma. This felsic magma, it is unique mineral composition and grind size because it gets settled down at a very low temperature. So it gets lot of time to crystallize. So uniform size of grinds are noticed in felsic magma. Intermediate magma is one here, the percentage of silica component is between 53 to 65. The end product from this intermediate magma is andesite and diorite. So these minerals, these rock types are found from intermediate magma. And the dominant minerals in these rocks include from this magma. Dominant minerals from the rock, it is noticed that pyroxene group of minerals, amphibolite group of minerals, and albitonathite, plagioclase series of minerals. So this is the intermediate magma end product. And mafic is one. It is rich in calcium, iron, magnesium, and poor in silica. See, percentage of silica is high, percentage of silica is intermediate, and it starts between 45 to 52 poor. And here it is less than that, 38 to 45 silica. And the rocks from this magma include basalt and gabbro is the major end component of mafic magma. These rocks are dominated by the minerals like pyroxene. Ultramafic, very low silica, silica percentage is 38 to 45. So this we have to keep it in our mind, from felsic to ultramafic, what will be the end product. And this magma is also called as picritic. Normally this will be there in one word questions, what is picritic magma? Picritic magma is nothing but ultramafic magma. And as we know that ultramafic magmas have a very less content of silica. So that's why this is called ultramafic magma. And because of less content of silica, viscosity will be very low here. Calcium rich plagioclase feldspar and alumine is the end product of this magma. This mineral is formed with very high temperature, but here it is very low temperature. So this is what this relation is explained by a great scientist called Norman Levin Bowen, NL Bowen, 1885. You see that in those years they dedicated to understand how magma will crystallize from higher temperature to lower temperature at different pressure and temperature, what will be the variant. He has brought an ideal situation of understanding this temperature magma. He found that there are two series of settlement of temperature pressure variation. One is discontinuous series, the other one is continuous series. At a certain temperature, magma produce olivine. The olivine would react with the residual magma, I mean already existing magma, and change the next mineral on the series. A continue cooling and the pyroxene will form, would convert to amphibole, and then you will get your biotite. So this is, it is not a continuous. So it is a discontinuous. A mineral formed and it is reacted, part of mineral settled down and part of mineral reacted with other magma, and the end product is pyroxene. Pyroxene is interacted again with magma, again you will get amphibole, again amphibole interacted, a part of the amphibole is settled and part of the amphibole and the residual magma interact, and so it is no way connected, olivine with pyroxene, pyroxene with amphibole. It's all different end mineral, different silicate structure, different compositions. It's not having any uniqueness here. That's why it is a discontinuous from one group of mineral to another group of mineral. The other side, he found that there is very interesting, when the temperature and pressure reduces, what will happen, you have a continuous series of deposition from felsic to quartz. So in some early formed minerals, react the melt to form new minerals, and they differ from composition and crystallized structures. It has a continuous process. So you have your olivine here, you have after olivine pyroxene will form, pyroxene to amphibole and biotite. You see that this is the mineral normally, where you can find even the structure, even the composition, everything varies from one end to another end. But here you have some sort of uniqueness will be there. First calcium rich plagioclase, sodium rich plagioclase, calcium and sodium. So this is how it forms in a continuous series. And he has explained with a very classical diagram, and this is NL Bowen reaction diagram. Normally all geologists should always keep in their mind that how this this diagram should go to their mind, that this is discontinuous series of minerals. Once if it is crystallized from varying temperature pressure condition, this is continuous series. And here the temperature will be high at this point, so this is ultramafic. Here your silica will not get settled down, your magma will allow to settle down first with ultramafic. Here for 38 to 45% of quartz only will be taken to form olivine or calcium rich mineral. And if the temperature reduces, whatever the residue of alumine will interact with the magma and it forms pyroxene. Pyroxene interact with and then amphibole. Amphibole means it does not 100% converting from alumine to pyroxene, pyroxene to amphibole. It means some remnants would be there in the pyroxene. As the pyroxene, it will get settled down, and some part of amphibole will get settled down, and then it will move to biotite and finally mica. Whereas here calcium rich mineral will first get settled down and to form as a plagioclase series of feldspar, and then end member as sodium rich. Whatever it is rest over, and finally you have potassium feldspar and muscovite feldspar from both, and then finally you will get your quartz. Here from ultramafic to mafic will come, mafic to intermediate, it means quartz will increase and finally quartz will settle down, quartz alone at a lower temperature, wherein you get a good size composition, mineral size will be more at the end product of it. So that is the speciality. And coming to understand the same diagram, so this diagram frequently appears because this is very very important diagram. People will always discuss about high temperature to low temperature. There are two end members, in high temperature at discontinuous what will happen, and continuous what will happen. At discontinuous olivine will form, and at continuous calcium rich plagioclase feldspar will form. And then slowly when the temperature reduces and pressure varies, pyroxene will form, and here calcium rich plagioclase will form. And then slowly if the temperature reduces, amphibole will form, and then at the same temperature it continues. And then if the temperature reduces, biotite will form here sodium rich, from calcium rich to sodium, calcium to sodium end member, albite to anorthite member of feldspars will form at one side continuously, and whatever the rest over potash feldspar will come and muscovite will form, and then at low temperature you will get your quartz. So this is very very interesting diagram. We have to keep it, all geologists should have their mind that how the different minerals will occur in different temperature and pressure is contained, then only you will be able to study in the field. So this is olivine. It is a ferromagnesium mineral. It is light green, glassy in nature, often granular in structure. It doesn't have any cleavage. In most scale hardness, the olivine is 6.5 to 7. And the specific gravity of this olivine is 3.4 to 4.5. And the luster is, you know, that it will have vitreous luster. And this is a pyroxene mineral, a ferromagnesium. That's why it's, it looks like black in color. Dark green to black, glassy, metallic, you know, it is having shining on it, on the surface of it. Streak white, light green to light brown, and most scale of hardness for this is 5 to 6.5. And again biotite, it's more, there is less silica, that's why it's more black luster. It is also vitreous, ferromagnesium mineral, block color, shiny nature, basal cleavage, you will get basal cleavage. One cleavage resulting in thin section, that's why it looks like a sheet-like structure. In most scale hardness, it is between 2.5 to 3, and specific gravity varies between 2.7 to 3.5. Amphibole, a ferromagnesium mineral, black shiny in nature. You see, it has elongated structure of crystals, 60 to 120 degree cleavage. Most scale of hardness is 5 to 6, and streak is white luster. So this is orthoclase feldspar. So silicate mineral, you have pink in color because quartz, this is at the right hand side, it is coming continuous series. Quartz is more felsic component. So luster is vitreous, streak is white, fracture is conchoidal, cleavage is very perfect. And muscovite mica, you see again quartz content increases here, quartz content increases, quartz content increases. That's why it's a pure quartz. White in color, cleavage perfect, fracture micaceous, 2 to 2.5, vitreous PLE luster. And white streak. So this is a silicate mineral, plagioclase feldspar, white grey in color, luster is vitreous, most scale of hardness for this is 6 to 6.5, white streak. Specific gravity varies between 2.6 to 2.76. This is oxide mineral, milky, white or rose or honey yellow in color, luster is vitreous, cleavage is indistinct, fracture is conchoidal, most scale of hardness is 7 for this quartz. So this is how and the Bowens reaction principles is understand from continuous to discontinuous. So this is universal law of understanding a magma at different temperature and pressure conditions, how you get different sets of minerals, one in continuous, one in discontinuous, and it joins at a particular place, and then finally you get your quartz rich, silica rich mineral. Thank you very much.